so used to not having them. Amen? Amen. Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. Where is your shadow turning with thee? Thou changest not thy compassion, faithful God.
Jesus' name, through his blood, upon his promises, and for his glory, we pray, depending upon, trusting in, relying on the blessed Holy Spirit. Oh, would you preside over this service? Would you anoint us, oh God, with thy presence and power? Would you speak to our hearts individually and collectively as a New Testament church? Thank you for the privilege to meet together, and in thy name, that you might be in the midst of us. We thank you for answers to prayer, Lord, regarding our sick folk, and Lord, that they're getting better, and Lord, saved and delivered from severe sickness, some of them. Thank you for those that are faithful this morning.
Yes.
To Lord, our temporary meeting place. Bless Brother Clary as he leaves. Thank you for his ministry of helps and strengthening us in the service. And for each member, Lord, their purpose and their faithfulness to you. And we pray for revival in America, revival in our church and our homes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. It's almost, y'all should know this one. It's not on the song, but you should know this one. We'll do it. All right.
Oh, victory! beyond the resource sea, the valley of singing, and your redemption story, and some sweet day I'll sing again the song of victory.
From you, Lord. Oh, the encouragement we need, the lifting up we need, oh, the repenting that we need, Lord, yes, drawing closer to you. Precious Father, please, as your Holy Spirit abides and sits upon your worship today, Lord, may he do the work you sent him to do in our hearts, our lives, and in our church.
Yes.
Oh, precious Father, how this world needs your witness through us to impact this world, Lord, to somehow make a dent where we've been, Lord. Please today lift up our pastor. Lord, encourage him, strengthen him, Lord. Preach through him, we pray. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Amen. Oh, Lord, Victor, you want to come and take the offering, please, or receive it?
Envelopes?
Their envelopes are over there if anybody needs them. Take your Bibles and turn back to Matthew 22. We're going to continue our series on the thing that's the most important to God for the children of God, the thing that matters most to our Heavenly Father, our Creator, our Lord, and our God. And we find that in the text today, Matthew 22. We'll just refresh ourselves with the setting. And it said, when the Pharisees had heard that he put the Sadducees to silence, They gathered together, and that meant with them. So two enemies joined together that they might fight Christ. And then one of them, which was a lawyer, asked him a question, tempting him and saying, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? And Jesus said unto him, here it is. This is the greatest commandment of God's entire word. Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. And this is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Now today we're going to move from the first and the greatest commandment. We're going to move to the second great commandment, which is verse 49. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. I know the first commandment is very difficult, but so also is the second commandment. To love anybody as yourself is a real challenge. The Bible says no man hateth his own flesh, his own body, but takes care of it. And Jesus said as we love ourselves, we should love our fellow man. So there's a teaching going around today that the first thing you need to do is learn how to love yourself. Love yourself first and foremost. Now, that's not a biblical teaching.
Amen.
That's not the teaching of Christ. That's not the teaching of the Bible. That's the teaching of modern men and philosophies out of hell. But the problem is today that we love ourselves too much. I believe selfishness is the number one problem in our marriages, our homes, our churches, and daily relationship. It's selfishness. I think we're suffering from loving self too much and rather than not enough. Now, I forgot my glasses, and all of my brains up here is blurry, so bear with me. So we need to love ourselves. If we love ourselves more than the Lord, we're breaking this great commandment. If we love ourselves more than we do others, we're breaking this commandment. See, as a man treats himself, he ought to be treating his fellow man. That's hard to do. For no man hateth his own flesh, but nourish it, cherish it, takes care of it, feeds it, clothes it, rests it, and tries to keep it from hurting. And so it is we ought to do with our fellow man. Now, one of the most amazing things in Scripture, and I hope you got it in your heart, Jesus gave these two great commandments. Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Number two, love your neighbor as yourself. But then he added a third. Just before he went to the cross, he was discipling his disciples, his followers, and Jesus taught them an amazing and a profound thing. He said in John 13:34, a new commandment I give unto you, that you love one another as I have loved you. Now, he taught us there's a special love that belongs to God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Then there's a second love. We love our neighbor or fellow man as ourselves. Now we have another AS. He said, I want you to love each other as I love you. And this is in the context where Jesus had prayed the high priestly prayer in John 17. And he prayed to the Father, Father, love them like you love me. In other words, Father, you can show your love for me with how you show your love for my followers. That is one of the greatest truths, is it not?
Amen.
In the entire Word of God. Now, the foundational principle. I'm seeing this more after 50-some years of preaching than ever before. The foundational key and principle is the love of God. The love of God. He bases the Bible on it. He bases the gift of Jesus for our salvation on it. He bases our relationship with one another, the church, and everything else on this. He said in 22:40, on the two laws, he said it, all the other laws hang on these two laws. In other words, the first law, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and the second law, your neighbor as yourself, fulfills all of the Old Testament law. Now, they called it, they referred to the Old Testament as the law and the prophets. So some of you know this, but just let me rehearse it to those that do not. The law represented the Torah. Amen. You've all heard of the Torah in the Hebrew language. And the word Torah means law. And the first five books of the law also referred to the law of Moses, but that God gave to Moses 13 months there at Mount Sinai. But there were five books of the Torah. And many Orthodox Jews memorized all five of those scrolls, of those books. Now, the Torah that represents Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, and Deuteronomy. And it's also called the Pentateuch. And Penti means five, like Pentecost, the 50th day. So we find the word five. So first five books is also referred to the Pentateuch. And I'm telling you this because if you ever study a commentary, you'll see references made using these terminology. Now that's the law, Torah, Pentateuch, first five books, all right? Now we come to the prophets. Now we, in our modern theology, teach that the law is Isaiah to Malachi. But the Jewish mind, the old Jewish Orthodox Jew, they began not with Isaiah. They began with Joshua, Judges, Samuel, and even David and Solomon. And so what resulted in that, you have the former prophets and the latter prophets. So you'll see references made to former and latter. And it doesn't mean that one's more important than the other. I've also was taught in college about the minor and the major, the primary. And just because Isaiah and Jeremiah has long books they were called primary, that doesn't mean that they're worth more than a book that only had four or five chapters. Man. So don't get that. So anyway, I'm just trying to teach you some basic things because we're educating you on the Bible as well as bringing you some sermon for your daily life. I'm just giving you some education or discipleship that many times you have to go to college to learn. So I'm trying to help you there. So we have these two commandments. Jesus says they fulfill the law and the prophets. Now, when you take the first five books and add them to the remaining books of the Bible, the remaining books, there's 34. So 5, 34, we get to 39 books of the Old Testament. And Jesus summarized these with those two commandments. So what God requires of us, the sum and the substance of God for everything to fulfill his word, is to love God and to love our fellow man. Now, to fulfill his word, to fulfill the will of God, it's simple, it's basic, and the most important thing that God asks us, love him. Love him first.
Amen.
He created you. He's your creator. He created you for a plan. He created you for a purpose, did he not?
Amen.
And I know we have individual plans and purpose, but we also all have a common plan and purpose. And God created us to love God and to bring him glory.
Amen.
He sought fellowship with man. He made us in his own image and own likeness. He didn't do that with the angels. He gave us his own image and own likeness so there could be relationship on a special level that only one with the image of God, the likeness of God, could have. And some of us never get into enjoying it.
Amen.
Practicing it, right, Brother Clary?
Yes,
we don't get involved in practicing being made in the image and the likeness of God. So we are body, soul, and spirit. And we need to worship God in spirit and in truth and have fellowship with one another, to walk in the light as He is the light, to be filled with His word until it's personalized, it's energized, it becomes a living word in our life. And so I'm not up here just beating my gums. I'm trying to get you to see that everything else is related to this. And so you build on this foundation. This is the solid rock that the wise man builds upon.
Yes.
And it's the love of God. So the greatest issue is to love the Lord with everything you are, I am, everything we have, our all. He said, with all thy heart, with all thy soul, with all thy mind, with all thy strength. Now we get that all strength as much as you have the power to do it.
Amen. Amen.
Don't give up easy. Don't quit easy.
Amen.
But with all your strength. So we see that. So that's the foundation. God wants that to be foundation of your home and your marriage. It'll make a good marriage. Because if you love God, husbands, if you love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, you'll have a whole lot more love to love your wife.
Amen. Amen.
You know what kind of love you have? The kind of love that Christ had for His church and gave Himself for. Now, what woman wouldn't like to be married to a man like that?
Amen.
Be married to a man that had the love of Christ, because he has the love for Christ. And because he has the love for Christ, God gives him the love of Christ to love his wife. And wives, it works same for the wife. And if you love the Lord with all your heart and soul, mind, and strength, you're able to love your husband more. You're able to, if you're loving God and obeying God and following God, then if he says obey him and submit to him, you won't have a problem, because you're showing love for God by doing that.
Amen.
You say, he don't deserve it. That's right. None of us do. How many of you think you deserve the love of God? How many think you deserve Christ dying on the cross? How many of you think you're good enough? How many think you're that lovable? You think God died for us because we were lovable? He died for us while we were yet sinners.
Amen.
The enemies of God.
Amen.
Unlovely, distasteful. And we was in the hog pen. And God loved us. He looked beyond our fault. He saw our need. And he died for us in his heart and his mind before he ever created us. Because he has all knowledge, including foreknowledge. So, why am I teaching this so strongly? Because it says, if we love him because he loves us. You see, if we could ever embrace and get a hold of the love of God for us, then think what it will change our lives. It'll fill us with, to be filled with Jesus is to be filled with his love. To be filled with Jesus is to be filled with his word. Be filled with him. So we see this. We need to learn these things. We apply that to the husband and wife. It works also for the children.
Yes, sir.
Children, if you get personal in your relationship with Christ, not just a head knowledge and I do, and I with all that. No. You get personal with God. You get at the foot of the cross. You humble yourself to God. I need you more than anything. I want you more than anything. And you surrender your will to Christ. And you'll get up from there with a love for him. And have children that love the Lord with all their heart, soul, mind, and strength will love their parents more. And they'll obey their parents for Jesus' sake. He said, do it for Jesus' sake.
Amen.
Matter of fact, obedience of the child to the parent was the first commandment he gave, and added an incentive promise to it. That's how important it is to God. He wants you to do it. that God said, I'll bless you. I'll give you a special blessing, you that obey your parent. You say they don't deserve it. You do it for Jesus' sake. The Bible says, as unto me. As unto me. Do it. He says, as you've done unto each other, you've done unto me. Is that not what he said?
Amen.
He spoke of the prisoner. They're not a very lovely looking bunch. I've preached in the jail for years and years. I love those men. I believe God gave me the spirit to go in those jail meetings and tell them I love them in such a way the Holy Spirit says, hey, he means that because he's speaking from what I gave him, the love that I gave him, not his love, but the love of God. And so many times that's what changes their heart. That's what wins people. What wins a young woman to a man? Is it not love? It should be. What wins a woman to a man? Love. And vice versa. Oh, you love one another. I've seen many of episodes because of who I'm married to. I have to endure a lot of what Charlie calls a chick flick. You know what I'm talking about? The romance and all that stuff. But do you know what that girl's waiting for in the proposal? You love me. Do you love me? You know that's the thing God wants from you more than anything. More than anything else. Not your good works, but your love. Your heartfelt love. We got to move on here. All right. So loving him. You love him for who he is. You love him for who he is. And that becomes the foundation of your life. Why do I read my Bible? Because we love him. Why do we pray? Because we love him. Why do we study his word? Because we love him. Why do we come and listen to the messages from God's word, from a preacher? Because we love him. Why do we witness to the lost and to the backslider? Because we love him. Why do we go to church and worship and serve God? Because we love him. Why do we tithe? Why do we give offerings to mission and to poor people that are in need? It's because we love him. Now we need to see here, when you love someone with all your heart and all your soul, you want to be with them. Am I right?
Amen.
Don't you really want to be with them?
Amen.
You remember when you was in love and courtship and you wanted to be together. Sandra and I would talk on the phone, run out of things to say, but we didn't hang up. Sometimes we might listen to each other breathe, but we just wanted to be together. You want to be together. When a soldier is on the battlefield or way over foreign seas, his duty, and he gets a letter from home. Maybe his mother, maybe his father, maybe his son or daughter, his sweetheart, his wife, and I hope the sweetheart and wife are the same. But anyway, but he gets that letter from home. Now, what's he do with it? He said, well, I'm too busy right now to read. Or I'm just too tired. I got other things to do. So he lays it down and said, I'll get around to it one of these days. Now, how many would think that? Oh, how much love is in that? Know what he does? He can't wait to get set down somewhere and open that up and read it and read. Now, my wife, she made straight A's in school, but she studied hard and she was pretty smart, and I didn't. And I majored in love letters. And they would give me a study hall every day to study math and history and whatever, and English. Well, you know what I did? I studied love letters. I'd study those love letters from Sandra. I'd read them and reread them and reread them till I had them memorized. Why? Because I was madly in love with her. I loved her more than anything in this world. And at that time, probably God too, I'm sorry to say, had to learn better to love God after that. But anyway, why? What was the motivation? It was love. You see, that's what God's looking for in your heart and mind. You pick this up, it's a love letter. Who was it that said, that old-fashioned country preacher? He was describing the weight in the balance and found wanting there Nebuchadnezzar or his son, what was his name? Belshazzar. And they were drinking out of God's Lord's Supper equivalent, the supper of serving the Lord's holy stuff in the Passover and different things. And they were drinking out of it and having one of these orgy drunk. They even had troughs, like a hog trough, out behind the building because they would drink and eat so much, they'd go out and vomit that up so they could eat more. That was gluttony, and it was an obsession. And anyway, finally God got so sick and tired of it, there was an armless hand that appeared on the wall and wrote in Hebrew, "Thou art waiting in the balance," and found wanting. And nobody could read it. Says, well, we know somebody that interpreter a dream. He's still with us. Yeah, he was prime minister to four different kings. But he wouldn't attend those orgies. They had to go get him. And that old country preacher said that when old Daniel walked in there and looked at that writing on the wall, he said, praise the Lord, a letter from home.
Amen.
It was, he recognized that handwriting. You should recognize God's handwriting to you. It should be like a love letter. You ever read it like a love letter? It gets personal, don't it?
Amen.
It can get personal, especially. That's what Psalms is. David mostly personalized in the Old Testament. Used to be five books of Psalms. They put them all together. But it used to be one in each section corresponding with the Torah. And there was a Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, and on down. And if you have an old Scofield Bible, it still showed the different divisions of the book of Psalms. It was David would read those Psalms, memorize those Psalms, and then he would write a song or a poem or a word of praise for God. And that's what he encourages us through song. Memorize, read it, memorize, meditate on it, personalize it. God wants you to read his Bible like a love letter. He wants you to pray like you're in courtship. I remember the old preacher come preach for me, wrote a book on the Psalm of Solomon. And the name of that book, a sweet book, was the Romance of Redemption, based on the Song of Solomon, the bride and the bridegroom. And boy, that old preacher, he had honey dripping when he preached out of that book and so forth. One of my nurses that come to my home, getting married here in a few days, and I said, I forget what brought it up. I said, do you know what side of the bed you're supposed to sleep on when you get married? Said, do you know the Bible teaches what side of the bed to get on? First time I got attention this morning. Did you see me all in my eyes? Oh, wait, look this way. What do you? I'm not going to tell you. You have to dig it out yourself. It's in there. But I said, you need to read the Song of Solomon to get some counsel on your marriage. And she told me she would. So I didn't know that. Her grandfather was a preacher. But anyway, everything God, he loves you. That's what the cross is all about. God so loved the world he gave. The love of God. The love of God. The grace of God. Look at Job. Job came after him. Or the devil went after Job with everything that he had. And he said to Job 1:9, does Job fear you for naught or nothing? Does Job serve you and worship you for nothing? Does he serve you for no personal benefit? And Satan alleged that he did. He said, God said, all right, you go ahead and check him out. Go ahead and put him to the test. And that's what Job did. He tested all of those human, physical, fleshly gratifications and lust of flesh, lust of eyes, pride of life, pleasures and all of those things and riches. And he tested him with all of them and took them all away. Guess what? Job still loved and served God.
Amen.
Still praised God. Yes. You know, he wasn't serving God for those things. God was blessing him because he loved God. And he put had his bonuses right. And he lived his right. A lot of us are just living for ourselves. And we wonder why something seems to be missing. But Job put God first, and he loved God, and we should love God. We should love God. So many people, listen to me today, I gotta hurry. So many people quit on God. Backslid on God. Get out of fellowship with God. Get out of harmony with one another in the church. And in the marriage, look at the divorce rate. Sky high. Even in the church. I listened to a sermon this week. A preacher said he had to preach a message because so many people in his church was getting divorced. And so he said, we got to find out what's wrong here and deal with it. Those were Christians. Why? Why they quit coming to church? Why does preachers quit preaching? Why does their divorce? Why does children rebel and leave home and get on drugs and alcohol and sex outside of marriage? Why? I'll tell you why. It's because of a lack of love for God.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
It's a lack of love for God. Now, if you ask them why they quit, they're going to give you 100 other reasons. Now, some men will tell their wives, I'm leaving you because I don't love you anymore. And that's carnal love anyway, because godly love, 1 Corinthians 13, it doesn't ever end. I can never stop loving my wife. I never said I wouldn't murder her, but I said I can never stop loving her. But anyway, Sandra and I have been on the road so long now, it's no use to change horses, right? But I wouldn't want to anyway. It's amazing. We make those vows to God out of love. Amen. Is it not an oath of love? Or have you forgot what that oath says?
Yeah.
But it's a triangle. A lot of people think it's just between the bride and the bridegroom. Oh, no. God. It's a pyramid. It's a triangle. It's God, then the husband and the wife. And that's where that love, too. You don't only vow to one another, you vow to God.
Amen.
And that's why you should be very, 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 very careful who you marry. You sure? Because what God joins together, let no man put asunder. And that includes a judge or JP or anything. So, preachers don't preach that anymore. Yeah, they wouldn't get big crowds if they did. They wouldn't be popular if they did. They wouldn't get big salaries if they did. But those who stay with the Word of God, plus nothing, minus nothing. You know, I hear so much false doctrine taught on television. And they twist the scripture and they leave it out. I saw something this week, and it was about homosexuality versus adultery. As if one was accepted and the other wasn't. That's a total lie. Amen. But did they refute it? They said, no, you don't accept my homosexuality, but what about David committing adultery with having his friend killed? Well, sure, he committed adultery and had his friend killed, but God didn't condone it. God condemned it. God judged it. God Amen. Sent the prophet, thou art the man. And the judgment out of David's own mouth came on him fourfold. Amen. God didn't. And then he lost more than he ever gained.
Yep.
Yes, he did.
Amen.
God didn't condone adultery because David did it. He condemned it all the more. Amen. He said, you've given the enemy an occasion to blaspheme. If you dare to take the Bible to condone sin, you're an abomination.
Amen.
And I'm telling you today, the majority of preachers are doing just that.
Yes, sir.
Just that. Even those, Brother Clary, that we know that used to hold the line. But it's not popular anymore. Not popular anymore. But what do we come back to every time? We come back here to love. Do we love God? Do you love me? Isn't that what he asked Peter?
Amen.
You going to serve me? Do you love me? He said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Is that not what he told his disciples?
Amen.
You're going to keep my commandments, not to gain heaven or to gain reward, but because you love me. Tell me something God wants more than your love. What should be your number one motivation? Why are you here this morning? Are you to show God's love? I had a friend write on going to church. I don't know if Sandra forwarded to your church memberships or not, but I asked her to, but it was pretty good. But I wrote him back. I said, one thing, worship is what? It's seeking the presence of God. To come to church and say, we're going to look for the presence of God to manifest itself. Now, I know we have God within. Don't get nitpicky with me. But we want to see a manifestation of God. Yeah. Did not they have a manifestation on Pentecost and over there in Ephesus and on the amazing road of Emmaus Road and so many other times? God manifested himself to them. And at Jesus' baptism, God manifested himself. On the Mount of Transfiguration, God manifested himself. This is my beloved son. See, there it is. It's always showing up. The love of God, no matter what you ever, if you just put the Bible together, that's what's going to come out more than anything else. God's wanting you to realize that he loves you and he wants you to love him. He wants you to exist to love him. He wants you to live and die loving him. He wants you to go to heaven loving him and loving him for the rest of eternity. And when he said, why are you doing that? Because I love him. Now, I've done a lot of things in my life because I feared God. And I saw early on that serve God out of love and you serve God out of fear. But serving God out of fear is immature love.
That's right.
It's what a child needs, like a young Titus sitting there this morning, all excited about being here today and smiling like a possum that's eating Saltburn. And anyway, he's all excited. But you know, young people, they'll serve God. You better do it or there's going to be some consequences. Well, we fear the consequences. But when we get older, I remember the day. And my father was an expert whooper. He could whoop. I've told you many times, I learned how to dance and pray at the same time. Some of you haven't come since I told that last. You know how my dad taught me to dance and pray at the same time? He took me by the hand and took a belt or a switch. And we commenced practicing dancing and praying. And I would dance a jig, and believe you me, I was high stepper. And I said, then I'd pray, have mercy on me. Please stop. And you're killing me. I'm dying. You're killing me. I learned to pray and to dance at the same time. Online, I'm dying. Oh, that's what's But anyway, God wants you to serve him out of, well, I remember I started to tell this for this reason. My dad had a little black book because he would work afternoons every other week, or every third week, really. And my mother we wouldn't see my dad till he got home. I'd be at school, he'd leave to go to work. He'd come back at about midnight. Well, he worked in a United States steel mill, and he worked as a shift worker, swing shift they call it. Well, anyway, so my dad gave my mother a little black book, and he said, and you have to write down all of his violations, his offenses, his disobedience. And then my mother had three little glass shelves on the wall with these things they call knickknacks. And she set that black book up high there in the knickknack. You don't know how many times I looked at that black book, but sometimes I went ahead and got in trouble during the week. But when it got close to Saturday morning, when my dad would be home and I'd be home, there'd be a conference, there'd be an encounter, and he'd bring out the black book. You don't know how I learned to plead with my mother to remove some of those pages out of that book. Sometimes she did, but a lot of times she didn't. And my dad had a special bush growing in our backyard that made good switches. Because one time he'd tell me, go get three. He wanted to be sure he got the job. So he tell me to go get three. Well, I got the idea to be humorous. So I cut rings on the switches. So when he started hitting me, they flew to pieces. I thought it would humor my father. It did not. It enraged my father. I got sent back to the bush to get some reinforcements. And I learned a lesson the hard way. I just, that was too serious. Sometimes we play with God. But God wants us to love him. But you know what? I learned to love my dad.
Amen.
Very much. And I remember sitting at the table with a black book, and I had a change of heart. You know what happened? I prayed several hours that week at church alone. I'd go to the old church and pray alone. And I fell in love with the Lord. And I went with my dad that morning, and I said, Dad, whatever punishment I deserve it, I tell you, you've missed more than you've ever taught before. But I said, I want to tell you I'm sorry. I said, I'm sorry I brought reproach on your ministry as a pastor and the hurt that I've caused in our home to mom and you. But I said, I'm not going to do right anymore because I'm afraid of getting a whooping. I want to do it because I love you and I love
Amen.
God.
Amen.
That was a turning point in my entire life. I want to do it because I love you and I love God. I'm going to ask you to do that this morning. To have that decision, if you haven't already. And I know some of you have. I know that. Let's bow our heads and hearts to God. Brother Clary, lead us in a song. If you want to come here and kneel in the front or get a chair to kneel on, just whatever you feel good about doing, or just kneel there by your chair where you're sitting and make a decision for God. Maybe you need to be saved and you want someone to counsel with you. Maybe you need to get backslidden condition right before we take the Lord's Supper. And by the way, this is the time you ought to get right before you take the Lord's Supper, because it's a special sin. Terrible sin to take the memorial of the blood and body of Christ without repenting of sin. I'll tell you that. It can bring judgment. Our Father God, we come this morning. Thank you for the love of God that we have in our heart, shed abroad by the Holy Spirit. Thank you that you gave us that love. Lord, I remember hearing Ron Comfort witnessing on the street, and he told that man he loved him, and that man said, why would you love me? He said, because the Holy Spirit of God put his love in my heart for you, that's why. And that man couldn't understand it. But the love of God, we can love the unlovable. We can love who you love, bless your name. We can love each other. And Lord, help this church to love one another as Christ loved us. Oh, praise his name. Lord, speak to hearts. Save the lost. Restore those that are out of fellowship with you and one another, maybe in their marriage or home, their parents. We pray, Lord, that you'll, Lord, restore the backslider and revive the hearts of the church, that they'd be excited, Lord, to serve you. In Jesus' sweet name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's stand. What number?
138.
Search me, O God, I know my heart to
be.
Try me, Lord, Savior, know my thoughts and ways.
Hopeth all things, believeth all things, all right? Beareth all things, endureth all things. Well, in the other versions, it says love doesn't keep a record. So, I was reading Mama's Bible one day, you know, and then I noticed that, you know, she taught me on something really down the black book, and I got you. And I was sitting there reading, see, love keeps no record. But Granny was sitting there. You know we don't believe that. Read it out of the real book. You got roped down either way.
That's good. Amen.
Anybody need a break or anything?
We probably ought to take 5 minutes and ushers of Omar and Victor prepare to give the Lord's Supper, and we're going to give out COVID. Due to COVID, we got elements that hasn't been touched with human hand until Sandra loaded the tray. But outside of Sandra, nobody's touched these cups, and I don't like them as well as the old way, but they still serve the purpose. And so when you get the cup, some of them having a hard time getting the foil top peeled off. So as soon as you get it, start working on it and get it ready anytime we pray. All right, any questions or testimonies or any word? Let's take 5 minutes and I think the restrooms are back here in the back somewhere.
Just past on your right, just past the dining area there on the right, there's always a down there.
Hello.